Hi guys, this is Basan. Today I am going to explain how to develop a web application using Spring REST integration, and we will show you how to integrate Hibernate with Spring REST. So before doing any development, I want to explain here why we need the RESTful web services. RESTful web services is distributed technology and one of the architectural way of design our application through which we can expose our services over the network so that other consumer or other user can access it. So what is the need of RESTful web services? Let's start with one architectural diagram through which you can understand better. So this is one architectural diagram. This is one dummy architectural diagram which I just created to explain. As we know, in real time, like in real world also, payment gateway is common for all. Like for bill pay, we are using the payment gateway. Through online shopping, we are using the payment gateway. For ticket booking also, we are using the payment gateway. So like there is multiple vendor like Paytm, PhonePe, Chiller, MyPesa, like these are only four. There is lot of third party vendor is there who are going to provide support for the payment gateway. So assume there is no RESTful web services. There is no web services concept in industry. So suppose Paytm want to integrate with payment provider, means he need to write his own payment logic implementation. For PhonePe also same. Suppose PhonePe also want to integrate with payment provider, means he need to write their own payment logic business to integrate our payment provider. Same for Chiller and MyPesa. So assume if application will write their own implementation to communicate our payment provider, it will like looks bulky and State Bank also, suppose to integrate State Bank, Paytm write their implementation. For HDFC, they need to write their own implementation. So how to overcome this? How to distribute the technology? Like, so other can get benefited by invoke our services. So that's why RESTful web services came into picture. So let's see how to optimize this using the RESTful web services. So one more diagram I created to explain with REST how it will be optimized. So let's see this. Okay, so in previous diagram, each implementation are writing their own business to integrate with payment provider. Here, like one payment provider, there is one provider who is going to expose their service that Paytm, PhonePe, Chiller can invoke directly. Here, Paytm, PhonePe, Chiller no need to write their business logic to integrate payment gateway. That's why one application payment provider is there who is going to support for multiple vendors. Not only these three, there is lot of application is there. So the best example of payment provider we can consider like PayPal, PayTabs, like this multiple payment provider also there. So today I am going to develop the payment provider integrate with Spring REST and Hibernate. Let's start the development. Then we will develop the one in between them. We will develop the one, whether Paytm or PhonePe, Chiller, to call that payment provider, to invoke that payment provider using the REST API. So let's, today where first focus is to develop the resource, payment resource, where we are going to expose our service as a REST endpoint. So let's start the development. Okay. And people are requesting me to don't use Spring Boot, so that's why I am creating this using Maven project and with XML configuration and annotation. So let's develop. Create one Maven project. Next, make it web app. mention group group ID com dot artifact ID is nothing, is your project name. So I am writing it as a payment resource, else payment provider. I am writing it payment resource, payment okay. By default, when we are going to create any Maven project, by default it will take the JDK 5. So we need to convert it, like you need to set in build path JDK 7 or 8, whatever. I'm choosing JDK 8. Okay. Here is one issue due to JSP page. As we are not adding any dependency, that's why we don't use of this index.jsp also. I am removing it just simply. Okay, we created our application. Now to perform Spring REST Hibernate integration, we need some set of dependency. So Spring related dependency and some REST related dependency and Spring ORM integration, some dependency we need. So that is the major point we need to focus. If there is any version conflict, means like we will get lot of runtime exception. So I already have the dependency copy. I am not writing or I am not adding manually. I am just copy those dependency. We are not going to write any JUnit test case, so remove this JUnit. Okay, let's check what are the dependencies I added. I added Spring Core, Spring Context, Spring Transaction, Spring ORM, Spring Web, Spring Web MVC, Hibernate Core, Hibernate Validator, and MySQL Connector. These three are the required dependency to perform REST operation along with Spring or Struts. Wherever you want to integrate your wherever you want to integrate REST API, you need these three jars. Then Servlet. Okay, so we added our dependency. Let's do a Maven update. Okay, now to perform any web MVC application, who is the root component here? Root component is our dispatcher servlet. So first we need to configure our dispatcher servlet. So dispatcher servlet we need to configure in our web.xml. So let's write our web.xml. Main web app, webinf, web.xml. I am doing copy paste that web.xml. Okay. Here I configure dispatcher servlet and a URL pattern. Okay. And I added one more thing, listener. What is the use of listener here? Listener will always help us to do the pre-processing logic. What is the pre-processing logic? As I am integrating here Hibernate, like any persistence API, so I want to load those database related things before load my dispatcher servlet. That's why I keep it in listener. This XML file will load first before any other XML file. So that's why create this XML file. Create one Spring Bean configuration file. Here I am going to configure all related to the database. So as I am using here Hibernate, what are the needs we need to configure here? First one will be the data source. Second one, session factory. Inside session factory, we need to inject our data source. And as I am using here Hibernate 4x and Spring 4x, it's recommended to use the transaction management. If you will not use also, there is no exception. But if you are using Spring 5 or Hibernate 5, we must have to add the transaction related configuration in our Spring Bean configuration file. So first we need to create the data source. So I have already configured file. I will explain, no need to worry. Okay. So what first I configure here? I configure here data source. In data source, I gave the driver class name, URL, username, password. This test is nothing, the schema which I created in my SQL database. Then I created session factory. Inside session factory, I injected data source. And we don't have create any package yet. Our entity, our model class, we don't create. So we'll copy paste when we'll create. As we are not going to create table as it's taken care by the Hibernate, so we need to specify our model, because in model class we are annotating at the entity table ID. By seeing this, Hibernate ORM tool will take care the create table. So for that we need to configure something, Hibernate properties. These are the Hibernate properties. Hibernate dialect, what is the role of Hibernate dialect? We are writing session.get of bypassing the ID. So internally this dialect will help us to fine tune our SQL query. Like he will write internally select star from this table where ID equal to this one. So Hibernate dialect we need to fine tune our query. So SQL nothing, which query internally generated by ORM tool. If you want to display as part of your console, mention true. If you don't want, mention false. Hibernate HBM to DDL auto. What is the role of this? Here I mention update. You can mention create also. This is the main property which we need to configure. This key will take care to create the table. If I will mention update here, if table is already exist, it will simply update. If not exist, then it will create. If I will mention here create, then whenever we will send the request, it will create the table. It will erase all the exist data. And this is simply transaction manager. I am using Hibernate transaction manager, and inside transaction manager I am injecting the session factory. So one more configuration file we need to write to enable our web MVC component. As we are developing the Spring REST and it is an web application, we are following the web MVC pattern, so we need to enable the web MVC component. So for that, as I mentioned here, servlet name Spring REST, I am creating the same Spring Bean configuration file with same name by appending the extension servlet. Let's create hyphen servlet dot XML. next. So we need to add some namespace here. What is that? Context. Why context? Who will scan our bin? Dispatcher servlet. So that's why we need to mention our context colon component scan, where we need to give our base package. And what else? To enable MVC annotation driven, we need to add the MVC namespace. And as I am using transaction, so I am going to add transaction namespace also. Okay. So let's context colon component scan base package. We didn't create any package yet, so let it empty. We'll add later. And to enable MVC annotation, we need to configure MVC colon annotation driven. Then Spring MVC will take care to scan your bin and enable web MVC. And as I am using transaction, so I need to enable the transaction driven. Okay, why it's giving error? Add some package com dot spring dot rest dot code dot star. Okay. So as I mentioned the base package like this, so I need to create package on the same structure. Let's create the package. What are the package we need? We need the model. We need service. We need DAO. We need controller. Let's write one more package DTO to like for request response. We will use it DTO. Okay. So first create our model. As I am going to develop your payment resource, payment provider. So let's create one model with name payment with some attribute. Okay, private int id, private string vendor, means like through Paytm or PhonePe, through which vendor we are going to pay, so that we can confirm as part of response that it's working properly. Private debt payment date. Okay, what else we'll add? ID vendor, payment date. Okay, and amount. Private double amount. Okay. Now let's annotate our persistence, Java provided persistence annotation @entity. See the package javax persistence entity @table. Mention your table name here if you want. If you will not mention, it will by default it will create the table with your class name. So I am mentioning here. Maybe already I have same table in same schema. Payment table. Okay, then mention the ID. Okay, and I want to this ID should be auto generated. That's why I'm writing generated value. It will start from the index 1. What else we have to configure? Let's create one more transaction ID. Private string transaction. transaction ID. Okay, let's make it proper name. Okay, we have five attribute. Each attribute will be the column of our payment table. So I am writing the setter getter. I am writing the default constructor. I am writing one parameterized constructor to initialize early. Like, it's difficult to write setter getter multiple times. And it's recommended to implement your entity class from serializable interface. As I am going to call this payment service, payment resource through my REST client, so may it cause some error. So add the serial version UID. Okay. Now write our, we have to save this entity to our database. Okay, this with five attribute. So write now the DAO repository class. I am not creating interface and class. I am directly writing the class payment DAO. Okay, let's follow the format. Interface. By default, every method is public, so if you will not mention also, there is no issue. So we have to write public string pay now. Which object we are going to save? Payment class object. So write payment. Okay, now create the implementation class. Payment IMPL, payment DAO IMPL, it will make sense. Okay, implements from payment DAO. And let's annotate stereotype annotation at the root repository, so that we can easily identify that this class belongs or contains all the persistence logic at the root repository. Override the method. Okay, so inject here the session factory through which we can get the session and we can perform our database operation. Private session factory. Okay, inject it using AutoWare. Okay, here I am doing one more step. Like every time if I will call factory.open session, means always it will create the new session. So to ignore this thing, we need to first check if session is not open, then create new one. If it is already exist, then return the same. So that's why I am writing one private method who will return me the session object. I am mentioning the method name get session. Session equal to null. Okay, now first we will check the current session. If it is not exist, then create new one. So I am keeping it inside try catch. Sometimes there may be chance we will get the hyphenate exception. Try session equal to factory dot get current session. If current session is not there, then in catch block I want an exception, create the session, new session, factory dot open session. Now return the session object. Okay. So that in every request it will not be create, it will not create the new session. Okay, let's save get session method. This private method I am calling who will return me the session object. Get session dot save. Pass the payment object which we are going to save. That is our model class. So here I took the return type string to know whether like data is inserted properly or not with some dummy value. Return payment successful with, I am returning on random ID with transaction, sorry, with amount. Let's mention amount. With amount payment dot get amount. Okay. Okay. And one more method we'll write in DAO. From vendor name we'll get the list of transaction. Okay. Public list of payment, because through PayTM multiple time I can do the transaction. It's not like I'll do through PayTM only one transaction. That's why I took it list of payment. I want to see all the attribute. If you can optimize based on your requirement. Here for demo purpose I am writing list of payment. I am returning it list of payment get transaction. Get transaction info something. Info. Pass the vendor name. Okay. Import the util package. Okay. We need to override an implementation class also. Okay, we override here. So here I am using criteria as it's the select query, right? Select star from payment table where vendor name equal to like runtime value which we are going to pass. So write criteria. So first to perform criteria we need to get the session. How can I get? Need to call the private method get session dot create criteria of class our entity class. Class name is payment dot class. Based on vendor name we are going to fetch the payment info, list of payment. So our runtime parameter is vendor. So add restrictions here. Add restrictions, it is on class dot equal method will be there. Something is equal. This property name should be same what you mention in your model class. I mention, let's check, I think vendor only. Okay, vendor only. Vendor value, I'm not hard code any value as I'm getting the value from the runtime. From postman we'll pass the vendor name dot I will fetch the list of payment. So list. Instead of write one more, directly return. Return. Okay. So we write our persistence logic to operation to perform the operation with our database. So let's write the service now. Here also we need to actually follow the service interface then service IMPL. So here simply I am writing one class directly. Let's write payment service. I am annotated at the rate service. In service it will communicate with our database. Database means our DAO layer which we wrote just now. So inject that in service private payment DAO I am not injecting here the implementation class. I am injecting here the interface through which we can achieve the runtime polymorphism. I am naming it DAO only. Auto edit. Okay. Now, we need some meaningful response, right? So instead of return any string value, I am returning one, I am creating one DTO who contains the response with some meaningful attribute. Let's create the DTO class payment response. Let's create private some attribute, private string status, like success or failure. Suppose any exception, we need to set it as false or failure. And some message, like private string message. Okay. And write the date, current date, private string. I'm taking a string instead of return the util date. Transaction date, mention a transaction date, it will be more meaningful. Transaction date. Okay. Now create the getter setter. Okay. Okay, from service we need to call the DAO MPL method. So let's return public. I'm returning my custom response class instead of return the direct object. Payment response. Same method name I'm writing. Else you can write pay simply with payment object. Sorry. Payment. Okay. Then from DAO I need to call, from service I need to call the DAO. DAO dot pay now payment object. It will return me the string. String. I'm writing something message. Okay. So, but I am not returning this direct string message to my controller. What I am returning? I am returning the payment response. So, create one payment response object. Response equal to new payment response. Better to write with parameterized constructor, else we need to write again setter method. What is that? Payment ID. Okay, ID is will be passed by with the will be generated by a generator. So we no need to write the ID and the date. I will set current date only. Okay, so remove date and ID from our constructor, else we need to pass here also. ID and date. No, date will is fine. We need to only remove the ID. Okay. Transaction ID, will create something like based on vendor name with random value, we will create some dummy transaction ID. So suppose payment dot get vendor something, let's write it is string. So new random dot next int. Okay, and then vendor. Okay, payment dot not this one. Sorry. This is the payment response which we need to return. Okay, we didn't add any constructor there. Okay, so response dot set status. Let me add success. I am not handling any exception here. Success. You can check also if message not equal to null, then success, else set it as false. Response dot set message. Same message which I will get from the DAO layer, that only I am setting here. Then response dot set date, transaction date, current date I am converting as a string. So use simple date format, new simple date format. The pattern, you need to mention which pattern we want to display the date. I am using DD MM YYY then if you'll add A here, it will show the AMPM also. Then dot format, pass the current date. Okay, while saving as date also we are saving the current date, so we no need to pass the date from the UI or postman. So I am setting here payment, the request which is coming as for the postman, there I manually adding the set the date, current date, payment dot set date, payment date, okay, current date, make it new date. Okay, so let's return the payment response. Okay, and we have one more method, that is get transaction. Okay, so in payment response only I am creating one more field, list of payment, private list of payment payments. Okay, for that also create the getter setter. Okay, now from create a method in service, we will return the payment response, public payment response get transaction with bypassing the input as string vendor name. Okay, if I will call here from DAO.getTransaction, it will return me the list of payment based on that vendor. So we can directly set that list of vendor as part of our payment response class. So create payment response class object. Instead of create it twice, you can declare it globally at class level itself. So now call the, it will give me the list of payment from DAO when I will invoke the DAO. Payments equal to DAO dot get transaction bypassing the vendor name. Import the util package. Okay, now in response set, here also you can check if payments not is empty, then set, else set the false. Response dot set status success, else if not is empty, success, if it's filling null or empty, then you can set failure. So better to handle like this way the exception. So I am just manually writing it to show you how it exactly works. Then I am response dot set payments. Same payments, list of payment I am setting here, which I am getting by invoking our DAO layer. Okay, so we created payment response and we set all the required value. Okay, let's return the same payment response. Okay, so we write our service layer. Let's write the controller. So here, as I mentioned, enable transaction, like as I enable my transaction management, so here I need to annotate @transactional. Here some attribute is there like read only, false, isolation, propagation, you need to mention. As it is simple, I am going to perform with one table only, that is payment table. There is no join or no other relation with multiple resources, so that's why I am not writing any attribute. Suppose you have more than two resource database table, then you need to perform, like you need to configure those attributes, read only, isolation and propagation. Okay, so now we need to write our controller. In controller we need to write these two methods which we want to expose as a REST endpoint, so through which whether any multiple third party vendor like Paytm, Chiller, anything, whatever available in market, they can invoke. So let's write the controller. Okay, I am writing payment controller. Here I am writing @REST controller. I am writing here @REST controller. If I will write here controller, first of all it won't work, because if I will mention here @controller, disposer servlet will always expect the return type from this method as model and view object. But if you want to annotate here @controller and you want to return the object as a JSON format, in method level you need to write @response body, then only disposer servlet will understand, no, from this method we are not going to return the model view object, we are returning the object, raw object. So if I will mention it @REST controller, no other annotation manually I need to write here to return any format, whether it is JSON or XML. So for that we need to perform content negotiation. So if you will annotate @REST controller, so it will be good, no need to write more annotation. Let's see. Public, I am directly returning the payment response which I am getting from my service call. Payment response, pay instance, something. So to call service from controller, I need to inject the service in controller. Private payment service, service. Okay. Inject through autoer by type. Here what we need to pass, we need to pass the payment object. We will pass the JSON payment object from the postman. Payment. So if in normal MVC where we are returning our model view or any view name from this method, then here we need to write @model attribute. Here I am sending request as part of JSON and response also JSON. So only we need to annotate here @request body. And my request contain some data. So that's why we need to, this is the post method. I am writing post mapping. Some URL, I think pay now. Okay, now from service I'm directly returning here service dot payment. Okay, here one more like root URL you need to mention. If you'll not mention, it's fine, but better to follow the convention. @requestmapping. I'm writing here payment service. Payment service. Else payment resource. Okay. So one more method we have. What is that? Through vendor name, we are fetching the list of payment. Complete transaction. Public payment response. Get transaction bypassing the vendor name. Vendor, okay. Here my request does not contain any body, as it is the we are passing only one input and fetching the record from our database. So better to pass those value using the, you can use request param or path variable, but here I am using path variable as it is mandatory. This is the get mapping. Get transaction by vendor. Okay, this is the big URL. So, and I am passing the vendor name. Path variable. Vendor. This name and this name should be same. If here I will write vendor name and here I will pass, means it will give me the error. Okay, same I am returning directly from service. Return service dot get transaction bypassing the vendor. Okay, so we develop completely our service controller and persistence layer DAO and DAO MPL. So what else we left? DAO DTO. Okay, and we enable all the annotation driven. Okay, twice I write, remove from here. Okay, we are good now. Let's test our API whether it is working or not. Let me check whether all dependencies are in class path or not, build path or not. Deployment assembly, okay, it's there. Now let's run our application. Some exception I got, let's check that. Oh, com.jt spring rest code, where we write this? Sorry, we didn't change the annotated class in our configuration file. Like this model package is different and we mention some different package. I directly copy paste, so I didn't change. Here we need to copy the change the package. Here not only this by property annotation, you can write one more way also, property package to be scan, sorry, package to be scan, and in value also you can pass the same package only, no need to pass the class. But here we need to follow in same package, you need to add all the model object. Here whatever you have package, the model class, you can directly add through the list. In list you can add multiple value. So I prefer to use annotated class approach. Okay, now stop the server and restart again. Let's see, again we get an error or what? No, it's fine now. Okay, if you mark this console, as I mentioned in listener application context.xml, it loads fast, and inside that I configure all the database related things. So first this application context loaded, as I mentioned it in listener, then all the database things is loaded, then at end our secondary Spring Bean configuration that is loaded. Okay, and whatever we have our REST endpoint, that URL we have here. Okay, so let's test one first. What we have the URL in controller here only we need to copy. Okay, first we will save some payment object, then we will paste through the vendor name. Okay, this is post method, as I am going to send some request body. Okay, make it raw and change it to JSON. What are the fields we need to pass to store one to save one payment object? I am passing, we no need to pass the ID, no need to pass the date, as I already setting the current date. Only need to pass the transaction ID, vendor and payment, no, transaction ID, vendor and amount. So this field and whatever you will field configure in your JSON key value, that should be the same, name should be same, else it won't work. So transaction ID, amount and vendor you need to pass. Transaction ID, it is string, pass something tx something, then what else, vendor, vendor, assume I am passing here paytm, paytm or phone pay, anything you can pass here, and one more you need to pass the amount, amount 5000. Okay, so let's test now. Everything fine, payment resource pay now. Okay, let's test. Okay, it success now, payment successful with amount 5000 and current date. I converted it as string using the simple date format. This value, this is the payment response, and this is the list of payment which we are not setting as part of our response when we are saving one payment object. So that's why it's getting null. If you don't want the null value as part of response, you can annotate @json include. We'll do that. So now it's working. Let's check our database whether data persists successfully or not. One second, let me open. Let's check our schema name. I mentioned the schema name is test. Okay, test is there. And our table name is payment table, right? Check payment table. Okay, it's there. Okay, data persist successfully. Phone pay. Okay, let's add one more. Paytm, Paytm, and change something, some number change. Okay, and amount is 8000 now. Let's save. Okay, okay, second record also inserted successfully. Now add one on same Paytm, I'm adding one more. change the transaction number 00 and it will be 2000. Okay. Okay. So let's check with now the vendor name. Okay. What is the URL? Get transaction. That will be one get method, not post, because we are passing only one field. Make it get, change the URL here, pass the vendor name, which and that Paytm, right? Paytm, but whether it is check P is capital. Okay, now check. I inserted two record with vendor, same vendor, Paytm. Okay, some error. What is the error? 404 not found. Oh, sorry, root URL I didn't add it. Payment resource. What is our, okay, it gave me two record which we save. See some field message, transaction date, some fields are coming, null. To ignore this null field as part of response, JSON provided one annotation that we need to add in our DTO. Let's add and then we will check again. You can write ignore property, but I am writing here JSON include. Something include dot not null. Not, I am writing non-empty. Means those value, non-empty means default value it will be assigned. So better to keep it not null only. Okay. And write JSON ignore property also. Ignore properties. Ignore unknown equal to true. Okay. Now restart the server. Okay. Now check the same get only. We are not going to save anymore. Those null value fields are not coming now. That's why when we will add these two annotation, especially this not null, then only it will ignore the null value as part of response. So this is all about our REST resource integrated with Spring and ORM. So in next video I will upload how we can access the same payment resource from the client using the REST template. So I think you guys will enjoy this session. If you found the content are good, kindly like and subscribe my channel and click the bell icon for more update. Thanks.